Norman Foster is one of the most dynamic personalities in British architecture. In his eyes, a glider is as beautiful as an abstract sculpture, and flying is as exciting as building and designing. At a time when modern architecture is getting a bad press, he's full of optimism and confidence. He's a man who likes challenges, and his buildings are daring, thrilling, and fun. When did you get interested in flying?
Quite young, really. When I was still at school.
You couldn't do any flying up in Manchester, could you?
No, that was the problem. I mean, it was too far away from the nearest gliding site, which was in Derbyshire. It's quite a long way away.
Was your first hero an aviator or an architect?
An architect, Le Corbusier. I remember this book from public library, school. Towards a new architecture, and you know, the images, 1927 images of aircraft, and racing cars on the same page as the Parthenon, and the Parthenon repeats itself. And I think what is exciting about, what has certainly excited me when I was young, still excites me now, is the fact that somebody could really gain lessons from the past and at the same time be inspired by the technology of the day.
Norman Foster works from his headquarters in Fitzroy Street, London. The mirror glass facade is almost a trademark. The street seems to meet the carpet without a break. The office is smart, colourful, highly design conscious, but it's not a showcase. The open plan atmosphere is young in spirit, informal yet intent.
You've got the basis for admitting light. You've also got the basis for planting.
That's right. I mean,
you can also relate that to water, so that the water...
There's all the difference in the world between building ideal homes and designing the multi-million pound projects with which Foster gets involved. We've come a long way since the days of Christopher Wren, when a few elegant drawings gave a clear impression of what a building was all about. In a modern practice like this, design is a process.
We complement each other, we bring different points of emphasis to bear, technical emphasis, legal emphasis, a range of skills. To that extent, we're an integrated team. I don't think if you moved around the office, you would be able to identify, you know, perhaps who came out of an engineering background, who came out of a traditional architecture background, who's the person who really knows how to put a building together on the site, or direct subcontractors, who could actually sort of envisage the dry bones of a plan and what they might mean three-dimensionally, because we all work together. I mean, communications are vital. So it's really key people around a table.
Instead of that level change being an embarrassment, you're really able to exploit it. So you're starting to get sort of terraces, I mean terraces that you could sit in, sort of, you know, ramps.
Eavesdropping on their talks gave me a better idea of how they work than any number of models, plans or drawings.
It would be a gallery in itself. Yeah. I mean,
yeah, well, this would just be another space in the statue square. I mean, there'd be more than others.
Right, yes. Back. Yes.
And structurally it's the same style, system of style, so to speak. Yeah.
And if you just put that on one side, I think there was another point that was made by, I think it's one of the Qantas surveyors, and that was that the
one of the earlier ideas where we created a space which was based on sort of some of those things from Raffles, you know, old colonial hotels, I mean, water, greenery and so on. You know, he felt it was really rather sad that we've lost that. What
if you put Foster Associates together, had won a competition to design a banking headquarters in Hong Kong. If the final plans were approved, it would be worth at least £200 million.
It's this dilemma, you know, if you enter the building, the fact that there is a bank at the upper level and there's a bank at a lower level is, it's schizophrenic.
But there are certain functions that need to actually be in the ground and be secure on a part of the vault space, like safe deposits, which have the little old ladies coming in to look at their gold all the time. And I think that would be quite difficult to actually push that up into the air.
It would be very mistaken when we're talking about things like high technology buildings to dismiss the idea that there's a human involvement. The loving care is still there. I mean, it's, you know, it's not being done by robots. It involves people, and that's central to the activity.
Foster has a reputation for getting things done. Computer technology in Hertfordshire needed a temporary building to house 80 designers within 6 weeks. The answer was an inflatable that went up in 55 minutes. In London Docks, the Olsen shipping line needed a freight and passenger terminal. Foster nearly caused a revolution by giving dockers and management the same toilets and fitted carpets. But the big chance came in the early 1970s and in Ipswich. At that time, many businesses were being encouraged to move out of London, and amongst them was a long-established firm of insurance brokers. Willis, Faber and Dumas bought a site and asked Foster to design a building with all the latest equipment and a standard of amenities high enough to encourage 1,400 staff to move into the provinces. Foster's solution covered every inch of the ground. It was clad from top to bottom in an apparently seamless membrane of suspended glass. The Willis Faber building is a startling contrast to some of the others nearby. This really is a concrete jungle. It stands deserted, bleak, ominous, unused and vandalized. It's typical of a multitude of misfortunes that have brutalized city centers in the name of comprehensive redevelopment. Foster approached his task in a radically different spirit.
We could follow the pattern of those existing office buildings. Floor, stacked on floor, generated around a central lift and stair tower. Each level being essentially the same, perhaps apart from the number on the door. Surprisingly, really quite a lot of glass for the amount of office area involved. And again, that in sharp contrast to the hinterland of Ipswich, with these lower, deeper building blocks coming up to the meeting house, the solitary tree in front of it. And maybe if we followed this rather familiar modern pattern, then we might have a lower office building alongside it. Spaces that are really rather meaningless around, and the roofs essentially thrown away. Now, we opted to go in a different direction, and the direction that we followed was to be inspired by a number of examples from the past, if you like, not the least being the existing urban fabric of Ipswich. And that was to respect the pattern of the overall low buildings, the nature of the more winding streets, and to produce a building that would respect that and would be an overall deeper, lower building. In some ways, very much in the spirit of 19th century models, whether those are corn exchanges or whatever in the north of England. And on top of this deep building, we're recreating the site at an upper level as a garden.
it's a nice place to be, but with some quite nice fringe benefits. And in this main kind of circulation route in the heart of the building, which enables us to get sun right down into the building. Glass, obviously, around the edge, so we can look out and also get that top light. Movement up through the building by escalators, far more civilized than lifts. And in that same spirit, recreating the tighter spaces on the street edge.
On the outside, the Willis Faber building is self-effacing. Though transparent by night, it remains a dark secret by day. Unless you know your way round, it's even difficult to find the door through a maze of reflections. But once you are inside, it has the glamour of a super cinema, complete with a stairway to the stars and potted palms, luxuriating in a world of light and colour.
If you think of most office buildings, you come in, the highest standards are in the entrance hall and they gradually diminish down to the workplace. Here it's the reverse. As you come up to the workplace, to the office floor, the standards increase.
Upstairs, it feels like being on a ship. The eye roves over those parts that other architects conceal. The roof is a lattice work of steel, which keeps out the rain, but lets in the sun. The view from the bridge is magnificent. Ipswich has gained a park in the sky, in a space that in other buildings is usually used by pigeons, window cleaners and maintenance engineers.
Flat roof, yes, but on the other hand, it's pretty maintenance free. I mean, it cut the turf and it's a nice insulating quilt. It's a good place to sunbathe, it keeps the heat in, it eliminates expensive expansion joints across the building. Again, it's working at a number of levels. I mean, it recreates, if you like, the site at roof level. There was a lot of discussion on the design. I mean, 10 years back, it did seem very radical, I mean, in terms of its use of glass. But it's used in a very direct manner. I mean, glass is immensely strong when it's suspended, and the glass is truly suspended around the edge. There really isn't very much for the amount of floor area, far less than in a traditional office building, although probably the appearance rather belies that. But at the end of the day, efficiency really is a total equation. The building has to be a happy place to be. If it's not a happy place to be, then it won't be efficient.
It looks almost too extravagant and glamorous to be an office building. Surely there was a price to pay.
It was quite carefully audited during its design period, which was 10 years ago, and was on par with standard office construction. So, I mean, it wasn't, if you like, a prestige building in that sense. It didn't come with an inflated budget. It was a standard rental office budget.
For every eye-catching feature, Foster has a rational explanation.
The ceiling was consciously designed as a dynamic element, I mean, in terms of its reflection, in terms of creating, if you like, a certain sort of lightheartedness, a certain fun, but at a very serious level, it's working acoustically. The light fittings, which were specially designed for the building, are low brightness fittings, so you're not getting glare. In energy terms, you're reducing the number of fluorescent tubes by a half, and that's a prime source of energy in a building, so you're cutting down the heat load at source. And there are a multitude of things around that ceiling. I mean, whether it's to do with sprinklers or emergency lighting. But at the end of the day, it's very much a visual element. And that is, you know, that was a key design decision, what it would look like, how it would shimmer, how it would reflect, how it would, as it were, enlarge dimensionally the feeling of the space.
Thank you. It all feels spacious and spectacular, full of life and movement. As you ride through the building, you realize that between the thick layers of floor, there's hardly a wall or a door in sight. It's not the place to arrive late or to leave early. When you get to the ground floor, you find a swimming pool. The water's like a sheet of glass, flush with the raised lips of the bath.
It was a very difficult site, close to the river, so it would be expensive to go down. The building doesn't have a basement for those reasons. But on the other hand, there's a fall across the site. So the that part of the building where the swimming pool is lower than this end of the building. So we take advantage of that fall. So we're not really excavating to make the swimming pool. But yes, again, it's more expensive to put a swimming pool there than it perhaps is to use it for paper storage or whatever.
Some companies spend a small fortune on showcases, decorations, and window display. Here there are no pictures on the wall, and no modern sculptures in the hall. Foster and his designers make a virtue of necessity. The building and its working parts are the art. Humble and unromantic things like boilers, plumbing, generators, and ventilation plant, instead of being hidden in dark corners, are brightly painted and boldly displayed.
The building is an integration of systems, the systems that are used to hold the building up, to keep it cool, to provide light. A lot of those were specially designed for the building. They're integrated and you really can't see them because the things that work in a building, if they're really working, you're not aware of them.
Foster believes that good architecture needs a creative relationship between the architect and his client.
There has to be some care. Somebody has to want to do a good building. You can call it patronage if you like. You can call it loving care. It's not expediency, it's not shortcuts. You have to work at it. And that means everybody. If somebody wants a building, then they really have to take some trouble about it. They won't resolve it on the golf course. So if we talk about Willis Faber, whatever, I mean, they didn't take shortcuts.
As the Willis Faber building in Ipswich reached completion, Foster Associates began their next project. The Saintsbury Centre for Visual Arts at Norwich is part of the University of East Anglia. It lies on the ground like an elegant cigarette lighter on a billiard table. Though as a building it's designed to celebrate the arts, it's entirely made of industrial materials, such as glass, steel, plastic and aluminium. It's been called a high technology building.
Well, technology is the art of making things and high technology is performance. And this particular material is a high performance material. It lets the light through very beautifully. It's immensely strong, lightweight, and it keeps the heat in, good thermal insulation. It's derived from aircraft floor construction. Let's put that in the context of perhaps more familiar building materials. A 3-foot brick wall, it weighs about half a ton. A concrete wall, 9 inches, air cavity, or 3 brick walls with air gaps in between. They all have the same thermal performance, the same insulating value. Except that concrete has so many overtones. I mean, it really is an unpleasant material. I mean, you know, it stains in the wet, it attracts graffiti, and no wonder, it's an aggressive material. It doesn't let the light through, it's, you know, it's a poor performer. Let's compare that with some of the possibilities around newer materials. This is a sandwich panel, nice and light, weighs but a few ounces, not half a ton, lets the light through very beautifully. In its beauty, it could evoke a lot of the images, if you like, of traditional Japanese architecture. Foliage, sun, some joy. Compare that with this concrete wall, half a ton of brickworks. They're all the same performance. But so much more joy in this. No drudgery. And relate that back, say, to the Saintsbury Centre panel. We're talking about a panel here, incidentally, which is twice as efficient as that one there. Panel, easy enough to be able to bolt into place, no drudgery. You can make a wall, a roof. They zip together. I mean, a gasket. Again, what is high technology architecture? It's using materials which we take for granted every day.
The University of East Anglia is a monumental concrete complex that dominates an open rural site. It was a bold decision to add to it a new building that's designed in an entirely different manner. When Sir Robert and Lady Sainsbury decided to give their personal collection of art to the university, they also agreed to pay for the building. They wanted it to have the informality of a home where things of quality are lived with and loved. They travelled the world with Norman Foster, looking at museums, seeing how things were done, and working out their own approach to the Arts Centre. They wanted something original and modern in spirit. It had to combine the direct experience of art with the teaching of its history. It also had to open up these pleasures to the whole university and to the general public as well. It's clad in thousands of aluminium panels filled with insulation. These are bolted through gaskets to a welded tubular frame. All the panels are interchangeable and can be swapped around in a few minutes. Inside, there's no attempt to disguise the fact that it is a hangar or shed, built to serve a particularly sophisticated purpose. It's basically just a frame with an outer wrapping and an inner skin. Most of the surfaces are tucked into the gap between. The roof is used as a filter for manipulating both natural and artificial light. It encloses a vast uninterrupted space below. It stretches for more than 100 feet across and nearly 500 feet along the building. I suggested to Foster that it was not easy to associate the technology of his building with its character as an art museum.
I'd like to think there weren't preconceptions, and this word technological, I mean, technology as a word is very loaded. I mean, I'm told that a root word of technology, technos, originally meant art, and that the ancient Greeks never actually separated art from manufacture. They didn't have separate words for it. So really, technology is about making things, and works of art are about making things.
Everything about the design contributes to a feeling of light and space. Surprisingly, it's only 24 feet from ground to ceiling. The whole structure exploits the horizontal perspectives of blinds and beams. The visual effect is so complete and unified that the adaptability of this building to its many functions is easily overlooked.
A lot of things are taken for granted in this building which would have been inconceivable in the earliest stages of the project, when one was voicing such a possibility. It seemed so radical at the time, and now it's taken for granted.
Such as?
All the benefits of being able to lecture about works of art in surroundings where works of art are there, taken for granted. I suppose it's this thing about being taken for granted. It's not the precious experience that you have to remove yourself to somewhere else, pay an admission fee, stand in awe, not be able to sit down, not be able to relax, not to be able to take it casually, informally, as an ingredient of life itself. The fact that the curriculum, if you like, might be based on objects which you can look at. The fact that the research might indicate that in every gallery throughout the world it's characterized by more works of art which are out of sight, out of mind, in the vaults below, totally unloved. The idea that here you could have the concept of an active study reserve, that a thesis student could maybe handle an object, measure it, play with it, have access to it and contact with it.
The Sainsburys and Norman Foster believe that they've found a way to design a place that's entirely sympathetic to the art it displays. It's a difficult problem. The collection is made up of many different items from widely separated cultures and periods in time. Being part of a personal collection, These represent one man's insight and taste. They have an aesthetic quality that comes from common artistic response to materials and expression. Foster is equally aware of the qualities of 20th century materials and sees no contradiction between the building and what it contains. But he has strong feelings about choosing modern materials that are appropriate.
I personally have great reservations about the way that concrete weathers in a northern climate. You know, we're not in sunny Italy where any moulding will catch the sun. We're in a damp climate with all the problems of weathering and streaking. But I think there are other issues which relate to resources, which relate to energy, which relate to drudgery, which do relate to an attitude around the way that you make buildings. I mean, for example, there's a fair amount of concrete in this building here. There's a basement spine which runs underneath the main space, and it cost a lot of money compared with the main volume, that part of the building that you actually see as the building. And there are some quite interesting analogies around the relationship of weight and energy. The large volume on top of that very, very small basement, I mean, for example, weighs about 1,500 tons. This basement spine, this heavy concrete spine underneath it, weighs a colossal 4,500 tons.
The centre has a space-age feeling about it. It can be tuned and controlled like a complicated scientific instrument. But despite its photoelectric cells and its invisible systems, it's very much a self-servicing building that makes the fullest use of natural resources.
In many ways, the technology in the building, albeit high performance, is low technology. It's not got all those massive refrigeration plants throbbing away. It's not burning vast amount of candle power. I mean, it's actually using the sun. And it's using the ingredients which were a vital part of the creation of the works of art. I mean, could you imagine somebody painting in a kind of cellar by fluorescent light to the tune of an air conditioner? Total contradiction. So to that extent, it comes back to basics. And it uses a degree of so-called high technology to do it. And it starts without a number of preconceptions that it should necessarily have Doric columns around it to signal that. It starts to attract labels like prestige building, and that's fine. The pursuit of quality is an honorable pursuit, except when it is automatically assumed that it relates to extravagance. And this is not an extravagant building. In actual fact, it's a very lean and keen building. It's something like a third the cost of what you would expect to associate with traditional art galleries in this country.
The Sainsbury Centre opened in 1977. Some acclaimed it as a masterpiece. For others, it was a sick joke, the ultimate in hypermarket philosophy, an aluminium fetish. Some said it was the most significant building in Britain for a quarter of a century, carried out with perfect control, tough, obsessive, willful. It was even described as the Parthenon of East Anglia. It would bring tears to the eyes of Praxiteles.
I do get uneasy around a lot of the current fashionable journalistic trends. I'm almost tempted to say that, you know, some of my best friends are architectural critics. I really do find it very intellectual and so remote from the realities of architecture. I mean, the realities of architecture to do with people, to do with activities, to do with spaces, to do with the means of creating those spaces. I suppose in a way I almost find it necessary to kind of pull down a blind. I'm much more interested in design rather than talking about design at a philosophical level. This image of the architect with a sort of 6B pencil sort of drawing a swift diagram which then gets passed on down the line,
for the engineers to engineer and so on, is a completely different way of designing from the one that we're talking about.
Foster has a passion for machines and daring technology. He owns and flies a helicopter. He likes to be in control. He asked me to fly with him back from Norwich to London. It was a remarkable experience. Only 10 miles from Charing Cross, we were flying over a forest. Within minutes of the city of London, new communities like Thamesmead struggle to survive in the midst of great wastelands. These seem to stretch forever on both sides of the river.
Battersea, helicopter, Golf Bravo, Golf, Golf Yankee. Helicopter, Golf, Golf Yankee, requesting H3 to Greenwich.
There are places where the advantages of London's waterfront still survive. But these buildings, which add so much to the romance and dignity of a capital city, belong to another age. Thames is a magnificent heritage, but we no longer seem able to use it to our advantage. Since the end of the war, much of the city of London has been rebuilt. St. Paul's is a reminder of Wren's majestic vision, but it's a jewel in a mouthful of false teeth. Even in the heart of London, there are places that look worse than they did in the height of the Blitz. True, no fires are burning, people are not actually dying in the streets, yet the damage to the human spirit is incalculable. But even in this desolation, £1,000 million of development will take place in the next few years.
Flying over a city, the bird's eye view is really very revealing. I mean, the river's there from the air, but you know down on the ground that you can't see it. When you think of those cities which have a special magical quality, you visit them as tourists, you return to them, Venice, Paris, Amsterdam, the quality, the character is inseparable from the relationship with the water. And apart from one or two very special places, tourist haunts if you like, London ignores the Thames, despite its importance historically, commercially. This wonderful visual ingredient, it turns its back on it. What countries, I mean, think what they would give to have this opportunity, this potential sitting on their doorstep. And what are we going to do with it? Are we going to go the same way as we have done in the recent past? Break it down into a series of suburban job lots, draw a planner's line around it, say that little bit will be housing, this little bit can be culture, this little bit can be industry. The kind of ghetto mentality or the committee mentality that will break it down into smaller pieces so that the problem will go away and nobody will be upset. I mean, where is the vision? Where is the equivalent today of that patronage, idealism, ambition, courage to actually take advantage of the opportunity?
So far, Foster has only had one opportunity near central London. It was at Hammersmith. Hammersmith is a thriving community of 170,000 people. 4 miles from the West End, 10 miles from Heathrow Airport. But its social centre is one of the busiest traffic intersections in Europe. There's hardly a square inch of public space where people can move about and be at ease. London Transport are the owners of the last prime site at the heart of this maelstrom. It's a run-down collection of shops and garages above stations handling 12 million passengers a year. The area has all the amenities of a self-contained city centre for the whole of West London. What's missing is a sense of place. It calls for an architectural statement that will be not only a landmark, but also somewhere that is alive. London Transport asked Foster to put forward a scheme for a complete redevelopment of their site. Realising that he was dealing with something the size of Trafalgar Square, and taking advantage of a plan to open up one side with a park, he proposed a four-sided, open-cornered building with a spacious piazza at its centre. The inner court was to be spanned by a transparent roof, which would generate a comfortable climate throughout the year. At last, there would be somewhere for the people of Hammersmith to go at any time of the day or night. All the bus and train facilities were integrated at the base, and from these, escalators led up to the open sunlit plaza. It was enclosed by terraces of shops, offices, cafes and recreation areas overlooking the indoor park. It would have been a modern crystal palace at the heart of Hammersmith's own West End. Almost certainly, one reviewer wrote, it would be the most important piece of modern architecture ever built in Britain. It could also be the best. Then, abruptly, London Transport, the client, changed their minds and called in a property developer to start again. I asked Foster how he personally felt about that.
Tragic. I mean, it was a lost opportunity. Not so much for this office, but in terms of what could have happened on that site. Desperate for public open space, an opportunity to reconcile the social and the commercial, to produce something that really would be worthwhile.
How did they tell you?
When we refused to continue working for nothing, they gave us a few hours and sent round by taxi a letter terminating our appointment. Not only our appointment, but the other consultants on the project. Quite a number of people were involved.
Were there reasons given?
No reason that you could really get your teeth into. Reasons that, for example, the scheme was now in the hands of a developer. It was not London Transport who were commissioning architects. That there'd been a transfer of initiative, if you like, to the developer. And the developer was commissioning his architect. And you can rationalise that down, if you like, to the fact that that we'd done a certain phase of work for London Transport. But a lot of reasons were bandied around in the press at the time. For example, the fact that the scheme wasn't commercially viable. I mean, that was nonsense. It was untruthful. I mean, a very respectable British developer. Had expressed a very real desire to do the scheme and gone on record as such. An American developer said that, for example, it was a license to print money. He wasn't talking about the offices. He was talking about the public open space, that very large enclosed area. I mean, that possibility of a round-the-clock, all-weather Trafalgar Square instead of another commercial jungle.
Yet everything that Foster has done so far suggests that commerce, business and industry need not live by the laws of the jungle. The bigger the organisation, the greater the opportunity it has to improve the standards of the places where we live and work. IBM, International Business Machines, is one of the biggest. They design, sell and service computer systems all over the world. It's company policy to employ some of the best architects and designers. They believe that given two equivalent systems, the one that looks best sells best. Foster's done other buildings for them in England, and this is the latest. It stands on an industrial estate at Greenford, which IBM preferred to call a technical park. The computer hall and all the offices that went with it were put together in record time. Foster called it Mission Impossible.
Well, if you take the fact that it was the one of the largest and most complex computer halls in the world, it was also the fastest. If we put that in perspective, it would be quite normal to spend a year researching, a year and a half designing, 1 or 2 years on site. I mean, 4 or 5 years would not be unusual for a multi-million pound project of that complexity. In this instance, we were approached in January of 1977, and we handed it over, designed and built and fitted out at the end of September. I mean, the whole thing, design and build, was 39 weeks. So we were obviously talking about a building which had a high degree of flexibility, of, in other words, it accepted change as a constant. And that is the reality of industry, and particularly industry today. I think it's a reversal of what most people kind of hung over from a past Victorian era might think of as industry. You know, I mean, industry really isn't any longer about clean and dirty management boxes, workers' sheds, back and front, posh and scruffy. There's a multiplicity of activities under one roof, a uniformity of standards, the ability to be able to cover quite large distances without going outside from one building to another. So I think, in a way, a building like this will get written up in terms of its technology, but I think the social aspects are really much more interesting. I mean, that's what it's about. I mean, it's about people. I mean, you know, think how long we spend working, how many hours a day. It's quite long.
The most dramatic part of the building is also the most down-to-earth. Tons of equipment arrive every day to be stored or dispatched without ever being touched by hand. A modern warehouse needs as much expertise and attention from an architect as the more glamorous office spaces and computer halls.
Well, if you think of the building really as a very large umbrella, and underneath it a kind of rich diversity of activities which can change. As you move across from one side, from the computers, servicing of the computers, programming areas, offices, truck docks, workshops, and eventually to the warehouse. I mean, a very large proportion of the total. In some ways, much more basic, but in ways that you probably can't see, quite demanding performances. I mean, the floor, for example, has to be exceptionally flat to allow those machines in the V&A part, the very narrow aisles, the picking machines. I mean, tolerances are something like 1.2 millimeters, plus or minus 1.2 millimeters over 1.5 meters. If you actually get a spirit level out, is very, very flat indeed. So the performance in the building varies, but all the time you can, over time, have the possibility of changing that mix of activities.
Once upon a time, architecture was a gentleman's profession, inspired by, say, Gothic or classical styles. Today, architects get their stimulation from Cape Canaveral, from aerospace industries, oil rigs, all kinds of industrial and technical innovations. And their opportunities come from managements who can understand an architect's aims and objectives, as well as they understand their own business. It's not only a question of imagination and enterprise, it's also about priorities.
I mean, the priorities are about a building which at the end of the day won't be wearing a label saying, you know, this building was built in 39 weeks, which excuses all the problems. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, the acid test is, you know, does the building work? I mean, you know, work in terms of the people who actually use it. I mean, I think I would be very suspicious of somebody who said, you know, we want to build a building in 39 weeks, you know, and that is the only thing
I would be very, very worried about that. I mean, at the end of the day, there's no substitute for actually wanting to do something well. And that has nothing to do with money.
It's often said that British architects do their best work abroad. I ask Foster, do British businessmen take architecture seriously?
I wouldn't know where to start to answer that question. I mean, I can't put it strongly enough. I mean, I don't think they're even aware of its existence. And that's a help, actually, I mean, in some ways, because the standards are so appalling. The awareness is non-existent. So, I mean, it means that if anybody really takes it seriously, if they take the environment seriously, they have a field day. So if you're an IBM, if you're an Olsen, if you're a Scandinavian company, if you're Volkswagen, Mercedes, Audi, NSU, Renault, it's great. I mean, it's teamwork. It's very enjoyable. It's very stimulating. It's very demanding. You have to put some effort into it. But I mean, the squalid standards, I mean, the total absence of any kind of creative thinking, or even the supposition that it might be remotely important what kind of circumstances people spend their working day. I mean, the fact that that is just so totally neglected by British industry perversely makes it easier to perform well with people who are really interested. I'm in danger, maybe, of overstating it, but I mean, the question is quite a provocative one.
And so, in 1980, Foster Associates faced their greatest challenge, and the opportunity was overseas. The Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation is one of the most powerful in the world. They wanted to rebuild on a site facing the waterfront. They wanted a building that would be a symbol of their status in one of the most thrusting and rapidly expanding cities on Earth. It also had to be efficient. It was to be as tall as London's post office tower. Foster won the contract against fierce competition. For the first time, he was building high. The design had to pass through many stages before its final acceptance was assured. It took a year to explore all the possibilities.
We developed an idea yesterday where, in actual fact, the whole thing responded to a pedestrian ramp. If you took a pedestrian ramp up there, 1 in 10, and it actually got you to a jumping off point here. Right. And Nick's been, I don't think he's actually got round to the really, really tricky bit there, but I mean, that drawing starts to show the way that all those, pieces to do with movement and services and so on.
But what you're really doing is lifting the whole of the thing up one floor, and I think that if the bank were to see that ground level space being publicly dedicated but with activities in it, but also incidentally acted as their own sort of method of access up the building, I think that would be could be a more attractive proposition than pushing it all down under.
Mm. But I mean, if you actually sort of, I mean, at a level of attraction, I mean, it's not full of fumes, noise, dust.
And it could have the archives, some of that display.
So it could be a museum, it could be the equivalent of Paley Place.
It has been likened to a Chinese lantern in some respects. But if we're talking about a building that will work in terms of the individual, in terms of inside spaces and outside spaces in the building, then quite vitally we're also focusing on the forecourt to the building. Statue Square, high density Hong Kong city, lack of public open space, and a very, very real need for it. So here we're showing the possibility of a deck that can extend right out to the water, in the same spirit of Venice, if you like. And that deck, for people, water, gardens, fountains, greenery, cool. So a number of activities going on simultaneously in design terms.
In the final design, many things had changed. But Foster had kept to the open, airy inspiration of his first conception. His transparent tower with 41 floors suspended in space will be quite unlike any other skyscraper in the world.
In just over a year, with something like 5,000 drawings, 500 models, how do you select out to give a flavor of the kind of drawings that emerge on a project and what they're communicating and to whom? Models of the structure, drawings at a close-up scale, the way that something will bolt together, junction together, the things that hold the building, drive the building, the way that that structure looks as it evolves over a period of time, not only two-dimensionally, but also as a model,
three-dimensional study model here to explore what it looks like, how it might assemble, and then maybe just as it were focusing in on that junction. Exploratory models, one of many, that will see how it comes together at a larger scale. And this moving around scale, these drawings here, to perhaps explain to a steel subcontractor how the building might be made in such a way that he can quote on it. The other end of the scale, maybe a drawing like this showing the banking hall for a board member who might just want to know what it looks like and how much it costs. And positioning that in the context of the total building. So this cross-section here showing the battery path, the cathedral, the link over this very busy road here, the way that they can be free of the traffic, moving across at an upper level through the building, bridges again over a main street, locking into the new Statue Square and other buildings around. At the same time, the movement of pedestrians across and under the building, water, greenery, not solid building, and the main banking space here, which is a vertical space, very generous, and the way that you get natural light into the heart of the building, the way that the building can grow upwards, a building that, rather like a tree, can increase and grow by some 40%, the way that key spaces for swimming pools, auditoriums, and so on can provide a rich mix with the office spaces as you go up the building, the way that garden terraces can grow, and the way that the profile changes, so it becomes a very distinctive feature in the townscape as a silhouette.
Up into the banking hall. Is that the plan of the escalators there? Perhaps you could take us through that, because just looking at that plan, it does look a little bit tight on headroom.
I worked that out from all the information that you gave me. So, it's got 2 meters headroom where it crosses on the diagonal there. Yeah. And I've just taken it straight from the ones that were drawn on the other drawings.
In February 1981, the news for Foster was good. The design was accepted. 4 years from now, Hong Kong will have a new £200 million business centre. It will be as gracious and original as anything Norman Foster has built before.